the podium over for me, or there's an official word, but whatever we're going to call it today. First things first, I would just like to say that my footwear choice today is not me making a statement, not trying to set a new fashion trend. Last week, you'll remember I was on crutches. I'm feeling well enough to limp around, but not well enough to, thank you guys, to put my feet through the torture of dress shoes. So I tried to color coordinate though, so hopefully it won't be too much of a distraction. Maybe Nike needs to start making dress shoes, I don't know. It was a privilege to be with many of our teens at Maplewood Academy this week. I was there for the week of prayer, and can I just say, well done, Southview parents. Our kids are some of the best kids there at that academy. Well done, Southview Christian School, who sent them on there. It was a privilege to see our kids doing so well. And I will say, at least as our kids go, you don't have anything to worry about. They're doing well. It's truly a privilege. You know, I asked them to, you know, Southview crew, raise your hand. We have almost a quarter of the entire student body at Maplewood is our kids. And it's truly a privilege and truly a blessing. And they are learning, and it was a privilege of being with them there this week. You know, and it gave me an opportunity to get to know our own kids a little bit more, too. You know, we brush shoulders, we rub shoulders a little bit while we're here at church, but we don't have a real opportunity to get to know each other. And we were able to spend some time together answering questions and seeking God together. And I'll share a little bit of that experience with you as we go through our message today. But it's appropriate that God sent me there this week in preparation for this message. Because this is the fourth and final message that has to do with our vision, our identity, and our vision. And as we've been saying week after week, the wonderful thing about what God has shown us is that this is not a vision that we dream could happen. This is a vision based on our identity that we already have. The people that God has already brought to this place. The ministries that have already begun to take place that we believe that, as we said in a past message, we can stir what we've got. And we can get the entire church involved to reach this community. And the first week, the first branch of our logo, if you remember, represents uplifting Jesus. That's right, uplifting Jesus. And we talked about how that is our mission and our goal, and how the other two branches represent and contribute to the uplifting of Jesus. The second branch represents building community. That's exactly right. And today we are going to look at that third and final branch, enriching lives. Last time we talked about sharing our hallelujah, experiencing, understanding, learning what our hallelujah is, and building community around that. And we said many of these communities that will be built are informal. There will just be friends who share a joy and passion in the Lord, and we'll build community around that. We're going to experience that and celebrate the hallelujahs of others. Today, what we're going to talk about is enriching lives, and often this comes in the form of education and ministry. So this branch represents who we are in the aspect of more formal classes and more formal training and more formal ministries that take place here at the church and that we want to take place here at the church. And again, I want to stress this. There are so many churches that are praying for people to come who have gifts and talents and abilities. This church has been blessed for such a time as this, in this community, with people here who have gifts and talents and blessings to be Southview, to be the kingdom of God in Minneapolis, to uplift Jesus, to build community, and to enrich lives. It's time to stir what we got and go from this place. As you've been hearing me say week after week after week, our new facility, our new ministry center that we dream will be a place that is that would be open every night of the week with multiple things taking place, education classes taking place, enrichment courses taking place, art and health, and we're going to talk about that a little bit longer. What you see is that this building is not the fullness of who we are. Who we are necessitates a larger facility. We'll talk more about that. You see, this building only represents a ministry with people who are willing to dedicate themselves to this identity. And we have an opportunity, friends, in this city right now to be the church and to make a difference for the kingdom of God. I will be inviting you through this message. It's our final message on our vision and our identity. I will be inviting you to partner with this church to really make a difference and share the love of Jesus to this city. Let's bow our heads and pause one more time before we begin. Father, we thank you for Jesus, and it's our desire to lift him up. We pray that we would see him here, we would understand his call for our lives here, and that we would take up this wonderful calling to go to this city and to work together as a ministry to uplift Jesus, to build community, and to enrich lives. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. I've always struggled with Matthew chapter 25, and you might be wondering how that could possibly be. If you have a Bible and you would like to, turn there with me to Matthew chapter 25. I'll be reading it from the front in case you don't have a Bible in front of you. But Matthew chapter 25, we have Jesus telling us about parable of talents, and basically Matthew 25 is centering around the last judgment, but also about our role in sharing our gifts, sharing ministry with the world. And he concludes Matthew chapter 25 with a very interesting passage where he says, he talks about feeding the hungry and visiting those in prison. He talks about giving sight to the blind, and he talks about ministering to people who need help. And in verse 37 of Matthew chapter 25, Jesus says, "Then the righteous will answer him, saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry?'" Let me begin back a little bit further. Verse 35 says, "For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty," this is Jesus speaking, "and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me." And the disciples are confused. "How? What do you mean you were in prison? What do you mean you were sick? You're right here with us." He answers that question by saying, in verse 37, "Then the righteous will answer him, saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you?' And the king will answer and say to them, 'Surely I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to the least of these my brethren, you did it to me.'" I always half understood this verse. I understood it in the context of God loves the human family. We are his children. And because God loves us, it's our job to help those in need. And the respect that we pay to other people is like paying God respect. I understood that. However, that seems very indirect, doesn't it? It seems sort of a secondary service to God. I'm serving God by serving others, but I'm serving them first. How am I actually literally serving Jesus by serving other people? How am I directly serving God by serving other people? And I began to study this a little bit further. By the way, the other application we use of this is we say, you never know when you might be hosting an angel unaware. You've heard that application many times in Scripture. And both of these are true. I'm not trying to discredit either one of these. However, there is an even more direct way that by ministering to others, especially those that need education and help, that need clothes, that need ministering to, there is a direct way that we serve Jesus to him directly when we do this kind of work. I'm going to let the cat out of the bag here right off the bat, and I'm going to tell you the way in which we work to build people up testifies directly that Jesus is who he says he is. In other words, when we live out the kingdom of God, we are making a personal confession and we are a living example that Jesus is the Messiah, the King, the Savior of the world. We are directly serving God by showing the world what life was always really supposed to be. So we are directly ministering to Jesus by helping those in need, by lifting up the lost soul, by helping those in need, by testifying to the fact that we believe there is a kingdom of heaven, there is a kingdom of God, and Jesus came to testify of that true life. Let's look at this a little bit further and maybe it will become a little bit clearer. We've been saying week after week that there is an arrangement in this world. We use that term worldly, and we talked a little bit about it with the students there at Maplewood this week, and I made fun of them a little bit, and I made fun of you parents a little bit. I said, sometimes parents use the words like this, you kids are getting too worldly these days. You and your worldly music and your worldly TV shows. And I said, you know, that's a somewhat of a proper application of that word, but the term worldly, as we've been defining it, and as the Bible actually uses it, do you remember the phrase that we used to define the term worldly? Do you remember what that was? The first service got it, so maybe the second service isn't paying attention. The current arrangement, do you remember that? The way this world works, how it operates, the way we treat each other. Nothing that we experience here is quite like God made it. Our interpersonal relationships, the way life works, the way we relate to each other, all of nature has been skewed and now operates according to the kingdom of darkness and death. Is that true, yes or no? Jesus came as an example of what life was supposed to be like, the way that God originally designed it. He came to be the material and the substance of our faith. Remember us discussing that? We talked about that this week at Maplewood. We do not believe in just promises. We don't just believe in black and white words on a page. We believe in our faith, the substance and the material of our faith is a person, a human being who was also God. The evidence and the substance of all that we hope for, knowing that the kingdom of God is true, is summed up in flesh and blood. Jesus Christ. We don't just believe in promises. We don't just believe in words. We don't just believe in sayings. We believe in a person. Somebody better say amen to that. The substance, the material, the flesh and blood of our faith is a person. His name is Jesus. And he came to testify of the light, the way that God designed life to be. Jesus operated on a totally different system, didn't he? He worked contrary to death. He worked contrary to darkness. He worked contrary to selfishness. He worked contrary to the decay of this world. And he lived for light. If there were one verse or one passage that you had to choose that would represent all of the character of God that Jesus came to portray, what passage would you choose? There are many that would probably work, but I'm thinking of one in particular. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For Christ came not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You see, the kingdom of God is summed up, the fullness of what life was supposed to be. What is God like? You look to Jesus and you know. What is God's character like? You look to Jesus and there's no more question. You look to the cross of Christ. What does God stand for? What is all of life about? You look to the cross of Jesus and there are no more questions. But I want you to think about what God says in that verse. For God so loved the what? The world. He loved the entire world. It doesn't just say that he loves the good Christians who sit in the church pews. It doesn't just say that he loves those that have privileged lives. It doesn't say he just loves those who seem that they've got it all together. It says he loved the entire world. I want you to think about this. God spoke hope into the life of every person, the whole world, in the person of Jesus Christ. In a very real way, by coming and ministering and embodying hope to the whole world, God says, I believe in you. I believe in you. So that when you see the light, I believe that you will see my son and fall in love with him. And here's the thing, you're saying, well, wait a second, Pastor, not everyone is going to choose to live according to the kingdom of God. And that's absolutely true. But what I want you to see is that because God believes and hopes all things for every single human being, at the end of time, no one will ever be able to say, God didn't love me. People that don't make it at the end of time will have rejected the fullness of God's love. There is no rational reason why anyone could reject true love. And thus, because God embodied and lived out in flesh and blood true love, and ultimately by giving his life, God will be determined just and the justifier of mankind. He spoke hope, he spoke belief into the life of every person. God hopes all things for everyone. There is no one that is without hope because Jesus is the light of the world. It doesn't matter what our situation is. It doesn't matter what our sins have been. It doesn't matter where we find ourselves or whether we've been privileged or unprivileged our entire lives. God says, I have faith in you that when you see the kingdom of my son, you will be drawn to that kingdom because I love you. I'm drawing you with my loving kindness. For God so loved the entire world, he says. And I love John 1. Back to our scripture reading. Now you're going to see how this makes even more sense. What I want you to see here is the powerful light that Jesus shines upon the world and that his life and now the church shines upon the world and his kingdom. Look at this. John chapter 1 and verse 1. When you're there, say amen. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him, nothing was made that was made. I want you to think about this with me for a minute. How did God create? What was the vehicle through which God created the world? He spoke, didn't He? He spoke, "Let there be light. Let there be a firmament. Let there be dry land. Let the oceans be gathered together." He spoke. I want you to think. This is a deep thought, but you've got to think about this. John here is calling Jesus the Word of God. Yes or no? Okay, let's stop and let this settle. We're going to take this slowly. What John is literally saying is that every molecule of the original creation, the gathering of the oceans, the setting of the skies and the atmosphere, the way this world was originally designed and made, the way life was supposed to work, is summed up in the person of Jesus Christ. When you look at Jesus, you look at why God made the world, you see how God made the world, and you see what life was made to be. And here's the amazing thing. John connects Genesis to his gospel, and then he connects it to Revelation. He says, Jesus is the light of creation, but then at the end of time, he says, Jesus is also the light of the holy city. Think about this. What John is actually saying is God knew we would fall. He knew mankind would fall. But when he said, let there be light, literally what John is saying is, when God said, let there be light, what he's actually saying is, get humanity to Jesus. It's an incredible thought. He goes on in verse 4, in him was what? Life. And the life was the what? Light of men. That's exactly what we're saying. Jesus came, he stepped into the darkness of this current arrangement, the death that it's leading to. He shined a light on what life was supposed to be like. This world would stone a guilty prostitute. The light of heaven says, I believe in her enough to lift her up and dust her off and say, go and sin no more. That's what the character of God is like. He believed in that prostitute enough to invest in her and believed in her enough to say, I know that you can live for the kingdom. I'm giving my life and my grace to you so that that can happen. I believe in you enough to tell you to go and sin no more. And he speaks that into all of us. He says, I believe in you. I have faith in you. That you'll be drawn to my light, that you'll be drawn to my kingdom. And as we see Jesus, that light pierces the darkness of a world that would stone a prostitute, a world that would compete with each other to step on the heads of other people, to help ourselves rise above, to hoard money for ourselves, to hoard our time as if it's ours, to just walk around our community and not even care about those that are hurting or those in need of education or those that are in need of help, to watch the issues in our society and just ignore it. That's the way our world works. But it's been said that Jesus walked through entire towns and there wasn't one sick person left. That's the light of heaven piercing the darkness. The good news is he has invited us to engage in that same kind of work, to enrich lives. I'm going to show you a quote here in just a moment that may blow you away. I'm going to guarantee it's going to blow you away, but here's the amazing thing. Christian hope is not just wishful thinking. Let me explain what I mean by that. Let's use an example of maybe a marriage that's struggling. You see this marriage is struggling, maybe you intervene a little bit, but then you say something like, you know, let's just hope for the best. To the world, the term hope, or the word hope, literally means wishful thinking, good thoughts. You see, Jesus is the hope of the world, yes or no? Let me ask you something. Then, is hope for a Christian literally just wishful thinking and good thoughts? Hope is flesh and blood for a Christian. Hope is material, and hope is action. Speaking hope into the life of someone else literally is not just, well, I wish the best for you. Hope, speaking hope into the life of someone else is action. It isn't just wishful thinking, it's active, it's material. Jesus is our hope. Is Jesus immaterial, yes or no? No, he's flesh and blood. He came as flesh and blood, and flesh and blood testified to the light of the world, the reason why we're alive, the reason why God created. The light of the world is the kingdom of God. It's an active, real presence, and it's an example that's calling us home. How does it call us home? Well, the work of the light works to build people up. It works to educate them. It works to pull them up when they need help. It helps the blind see. It helps the deaf hear. It helps those that are dying really live. We struggle with that phrase, you know, Jesus loves us in our sin or out of our, you know. I'm not here to debate that, but I want to tell you that because God hopes for everyone, he's active in everyone's life, Jesus loves you now. Right now, the way you sit. He loves you now and he gave his life for you right now the way you sit. But because God has faith in you and he knows what the kingdom of God can do in your life, he is overjoyed at your future. He believes in what you can become when you join the kingdom of the light. Somebody better say amen to that. Isn't that wonderful? He rejoices in his hope of what we can be. And let me ask you this question. Since the kingdom of God is not just wishful thinking, the kingdom of God is action and it's material, I want to ask you this. If Jesus is rejoicing in the hope of what you can be, is God just using wishful thinking and good thoughts on your behalf? What is God doing in your life? He's working. He's active. The kingdom of God is on the move in your life and throughout this world. You believe that today? I want to take you to a verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I want you to see this. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6. Let's go there together. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6. This is what the Bible says. When you're there, say amen, by the way. Amen. Look at this. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of where? Darkness, who has shown in our hearts for what purpose? to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. The light of the kingdom of God, which is shining into the darkness, is education. Is that true? Yes or no? Why does the light shine? To give us what? Knowledge. The light from heaven is education. What we're about to see and what we're about to learn is that by educating, by investing in the lives of other people, it lifts them up to a point where they can better see the light from heaven shining in their life. It gives them a greater opportunity to live within the kingdom of God in this world, to be the light to shine out of darkness. When we speak and teach and live hope into the life of someone else, it testifies to the fact that Jesus is the Savior. Whatsoever you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. Literally, we testify that Jesus is who He says He is when we become the hope for someone else. When we fail to do so, it shows that we don't believe the same thing Jesus did. Hope and belief in every soul. Whatsoever you've done to the least of these, my brethren. Turn with me to John chapter 20 and verse 31 now. I can't wait to get to the next quote. So we've got to work our way there, though, so you can see this. I can't wait until we get to what I'm about to show you. But John chapter 20 and verse 31, when you're there, say amen. Look at what John says. It says, "But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the what? The Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in His name." The light of the world is showing us what life is really for. The kingdom of God is shining into the darkness of the death of this current arrangement. And it's showing us what we were really made to be. It's showing us what life was always made to be. It's showing us what the kingdom of God is really like. And it's drawing all of us home. And it's for the whole world because God hopes and believes in everyone. He believes for everyone. He believed that every person could really live, could really see the light, and would really choose His kingdom. I have to share a quote with you, and I'm not going to tell you. Some of you may recognize right away who the author is, but I suspect that many of you will not recognize this author because it is the last thing you're expecting this person to say. You've got to see it, though. When I saw it, I was blown away. Look at this. If we wish to do good to souls, our success with these souls, listen, will be in proportion to their belief in our belief in and appreciation of them. Whoa. Respect shown to the struggling human soul is the sure means through Christ Jesus of the restoration of the self-respect that man has lost. Our advancing ideas of what he may become are a help we cannot ourselves fully appreciate. What this person is saying, it is the job of the Christian to speak hope and to believe in everyone. And more than ever before, what we've seen in our world is that people see right through surface love. They see right through hypocrisy. And what? This is Ellen White. And I'm just going to make a sidebar. Many of us have destroyed her writings in the eyes of other people because we use it to tear people down. You're misbehaving? Read messages to young people. Here, kid, read page 326 of this book. She says our work as Christians is to build people up. Amen. To restore self-respect. And what do we use her writings for? To tear people's self-respect down. You're not good enough. You're not worthy enough. You don't eat the right stuff. If she knew we were using her writings that way, she would roll over in her grave. Stop using Ellen White to tear people down. Use her, if you're going to build them up, Because she says if you want to win a soul, you got to educate them. You got to pull them up off the ground. You got to dust them off. You got to help them. And you got to believe that they can be what God hopes for them. The restoration of self-respect. And isn't it interesting? Isn't it interesting that we're living in a country, in a time where we have never experienced more education? For the most part, people are educated. For the most part, people in the United States are more wealthy than the rest of the world. If you have a roof over your head and food on your table, you are more wealthy than the majority of the world. It's interesting that we have been taught, it says that as we build up self-respect, as we give people means to see the kingdom of God, they will respond. It's really interesting that even though we've been given these privileges, we are turning our back on God more than ever before. Do you know why this is? We are rich and increased with goods and think we have need of nothing. Why? Because we have not been taught that when you see food on your table, that is the life of Christ speaking into your life. We have not been taught that every green tree and every blade of grass is the love of God speaking into our lives. We have not been told that when someone loves us and respects us, that's the love of God speaking into our lives. We have not been trained to bring every thought captive unto Jesus Christ. That, when I read a lot of the book Education for the preparation for this sermon. I read a lot from this, and I was floored when I saw this. Most people think Ellen White, you know, you got to afflict your soul, and you got to, you know, not smile for pictures, and you can never have joy as a Christian. She says, no. Believe in people. Build up their self-respect. And it gives them an opportunity to see the kingdom of light. The job of the Christian is not to tear people down. It's to build them up. To speak love, to speak belief, and to speak hope into their hearts. There's a bunch of quotes around that. You know, you can look at that later. I'll put the sermon notes. I didn't have a chance to put the study guide up on the app this week because I was at Maplewood, didn't have my computer. I tried to do it with my mobile device. I apologize. But the fact of the matter is, I read around this quote, and all these quotes, I summarized it into a sentence here, maybe two. I may have done a run-on. I don't know, Mrs. Hansen. You'll have to correct me later. The gospel requires that we hope the best for every person, and a Christian hope is not just wishful thinking. It's active and material. I love 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5. I alluded to it just a second ago, but I want to show it to you again. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5. Quickly, it says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. So in other words, the kingdom of God doesn't often make sense to people in this world because we're thinking according to the current arrangement. We're thinking according to the ways and thoughts of this world. We've talked in the past couple of weeks about the foolishness of thinking that governments and politicians are going to be able to somehow fix this thing. Because governments and politics operates according to the way the world works. It's not getting fixed. But Jesus is coming soon. So he goes on. In verse 5 it says, against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So in other words, what literally Paul is saying is that every act that uplifts and strengthens people is an opportunity for their mind and heart to see the light of the kingdom of God. I used to read the book Education and think it was only about our schools. I did. I thought it was about our elementary schools, and I thought it was... If you go back into education, that's a piece of it, yes. That is a piece of it. But the education that she's talking about is realizing what it means that light shined into darkness. What it means to see all of life as a piece of marred God's creation, but bringing every thought into captivity of the grace, the love, the character of God. That's what true education is about. It's about lifting people up and educating them and training them like Jesus was for the world. Jesus was an education of what the kingdom of God is like. Isn't that true? And as people saw him, they went, oh, that's what God is like. Oh, that's what life is for. And that's the fullness of education. Bringing every thought captive unto the obedience of Christ. We work for the good of others because when they are physically, mentally, financially, and emotionally stronger, they have a greater opportunity to see the light. You know why? Because it begins to crowd out the distractions of this world. And this is why the church more than ever before and our schools more than ever before have the opportunity to be a great witness. Because what people need to understand is that true education draws you to see true life as it is in Jesus. The building up of people draws us to the kingdom of God. We are to work for the restoration of their self-respect of the soul. Is that a refreshing look at the way that we're to work for the world, yes or no?
Yes.
Wow. Sometimes we have this idea that we're supposed to walk around our city and tell people what great sinners they are. Once in a while, we need to do that. I'm not talking about talking to people that you don't know. Once in a while, as Christians, we're to help people see that the way they're living isn't right. But what we have seen and what we see in the life of Jesus is that's only occasionally. The majority of our work, of what we are called to do, is to build people up, to give them an opportunity to see how heaven works so they can say, why would I want to live any other way? Why would I want to live for darkness when I can live for light? We are to work for the restoration of the self-respect of the soul. I love this. 1 Corinthians 9:1-9-13, saying the same thing. And so, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge. With the what?
Knowledge
of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. There you see it again. May you be strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints of light. He has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son. Wow! Amazing! And not only does this show our work to educate, to lift people up to the kingdom of God, it also shows the byproduct of doing that work. It also furthers our knowledge, doesn't it? It furthers our knowledge of the kingdom of God. So working as the light in this world, being an active agent for the kingdom of God, educates us more about the kingdom of God. It helps us see heaven more clearly when we're speaking hope and believing all things for people. The kingdom of His beloved Son. My friends, what I'm so thrilled about is that this church has the ability to do this very kind of work. And in many ways, this is already our identity because we're doing some of these things. We have our school, and I looked at our students there at Maplewood Academy this week, and my heart was thrilled. Because you are a church that never ceases to labor for our students. We support them, and we support our school, and it's full, and we continue to work tirelessly to make sure that it can stay open and do the kind of ministry that we're talking about, educating kids for eternity, bringing every thought captive unto Christ. We're dedicated to that. We have music education happening here. We have little bits and pieces of community service, but I want to tell you something. As you heard me say a few weeks ago, it is time to stir what we got. Because there are people, and as a pastor, I'm going to apologize to you again. As a pastor, I have not done a good enough job of utilizing all of you. We've grown too fast, and I haven't kept up with it. What I'm going to ask all of you to do, though, is help me. Get on board. Because, you know, we think that the next step is a larger facility for us. What we need to understand is that our identity is not a bigger church building. Our identity is uplifting Jesus, building community, and enriching lives. That's who we are. And what we believe with all of our hearts is that a bigger place is going to help us achieve that identity. What we believe is in a place where we can be open every night of the week, and there's addiction recovery happening, and there's art classes happening, and there's English as a second language classes happening, and there's music education happening, a place where people can come so that their souls can be lifted up and self-respect can be restored. To educate and to provide community for people that needed addiction recovery and physical and nutrition health education and financial seminars and a piece of this. My friends, can I just be really honest? For too long, the Adventist Church has thought the fullness of ministry is preaching a public evangelistic series where we go through Daniel and Revelation and talk about prophecy for an hour and talk about Jesus for 5 minutes. That is not the fullness of ministry. It has its place, but it is not what we've been called to do as a whole. We are called to be a light in the darkness, and that means lifting up souls so that when we present to them Jesus, they say, yeah, that's who it's been all along. Bible study classes and public meetings and revivals like we've been doing, but imagine a place. Imagine a place that's thriving with ministry. People say, Pastor, why isn't this happening here? I mean, yes, we can start some of these things right now, and I'm going to invite you to do that here in just a moment. But the fact of the matter is, this place is too small to hold what we can do. It's gotten too small. There are way too many of us who can do way too many things to contain it in this little tiny church. We need a parking lot. We don't want people who might be limping into the building or have trouble walking, trying to walk on icy roads without a... We need a parking lot. And we need places where people can socialize. I mean, where do we... The fellowship hall doesn't even hold a quarter of our members. We need a place where we can congregate and talk. We need a place where we can build community. We need a place where we can educate. It's time to get on board. It's time to go. It's time to see this through as we wait on the Lord, because we are Southview. And we are a people that want to uplift Jesus. We're a people that works to build community. And we are a people that want to enrich lives to show them the kingdom of God. That's who we are. We are Southview. And it's time to take this vision and this identity, and stop playing around. I'm going to be very honest with you. As I said last time, church is not coming to a place once a week and staring at the back of the head of the person in front of you. That is not church. Church is uplifting Jesus. Church is building community. And church is enriching lives. Now, don't get me wrong, public worship and corporate worship is important, as you've heard me say before. Gathering together like this is important, but do you know why we gather together like this? To share with each other and to share ministry. To come together and worship together, worship God together, but that's not the fullness of church. That's a piece of it and an important piece of it. But that's not the fullness of all of what we've been called to do as Christians. It's time to stir what we've got. And I want to just tell you, I want to be totally frank and honest with you, because this is the last of our vision and identity you're going to hear from me for a little while. It can't take a handful of us. You know, time and time again, I've heard people say things like, you know, I just didn't feel at home in that place. I'm not talking about our church. I'm just talking about in general. The moment you see people begin to leave the church is the moment you'll see that they are less and less and less involved. You want to experience the true life of your church, you get involved in the church. You gain ownership, and you get involved in something. And what we are talking about cannot be led by a handful of people. You see that, yes or no? What we're asking you to do is, if you have a passion or you have an education in something, we want you to open a class once a week. Maybe it doesn't go year-round, maybe it goes for 3 months. If you have a passion or you've understood your personal hallelujah, we're asking you to meet with people and celebrate God and celebrate His creation or celebrate your passion together. And it can't take just a few people. Very soon, what you're going to see on our app and in other places around this building is a job board. And what we need immediately, can I share with you what we need immediately? You ready for this? We need people in children's ministries. I don't know if how many of you wander by our primary classes. Primary has over 40 kids in there. You know, we don't believe in purgatory. But if there were a purgatory for those primary teachers, they would be 10 less years in purgatory for every class that they put on. Because it is a ministry and those kids are excited. And I want to just say this as a sidebar too. The limitations of the size of our building are going to begin to affect the quality of our ministry. We need to split our primaries into two or three. We have no space. If you walk around this building on Sabbath morning, you will see that every single room is full of some kind of ministry. We need to split up these classes for the sake of our kids. This is not just about a condition of our building issue. This is not just about worship. This is about our other ministries not having room. Pray tirelessly that we find a place very soon. We need help in children's ministries. We need help in adventurers. We need help in juniors. We need help in these different departments with our kids. And you can do it. And not every position has to be a teacher. You can be there to support and herd the cats. You can just be there to help. But you'd be amazed at the connection you build with these kids and those kinds of opportunities. So that's one immediate way that you can be involved. Another immediate way is if you have a passion to teach art or to help in music or to help in some kind of class, come to us because we want to facilitate that. I'm going to have a little registration thing on our app so you can communicate with us that way if you don't have a chance to talk to one of the pastors. The other way that you can be directly involved is, I don't know if you've noticed, but you know, for an older style building and for an Adventist church, we've got some high-tech stuff going on around here. We live stream to over 300 people every Sabbath. And we create DVDs, and we create various things. We have an app. We have PowerPoint and slides. We have all of these things. We need a multimedia team. Right now, I'm the app guy. I don't want to be the app guy anymore. I want to load my sermon notes up there and hand the rest off to everybody else. That's what I want to do. We need a multimedia team. We need help on our newsletter. We need help on our YouTube page. We need help with our slides. I won't go there. We need help in the back with our mics. We need help all around. And here's the thing. If you're a team, come help us. But what we do need you to do is if you are on this team, you got to be all in. Because if you're live streaming, you can't be showing up 2 minutes before service starts. You got to be all in. Let me tell you why. If we are 1 minute late, the phone rings. Is something wrong with the live stream today? Because it's not coming through. No, we're just starting a little bit late. We can't be starting late. We want to upgrade our equipment too. I mean, these cameras, they're a little fuzzy. The audio, not so good. If you've noticed, you come here to church and we love the music, and then you go home and watch and you're like, what happened between here and there? We need to upgrade our system. High definition, we need to upgrade these things and watch how God continues to make this go. We need to do these things. We need to put these things in place. We need your help for the multimedia team. We'll be posting that, and you can be involved in that. We'll schedule a meeting, and poor Ralph Kramer, he's scheduled meetings like this in the past, and he gets like two people to show up. We need a team, because this is a ministry. And many of you take these DVDs, you mail them around. We need help with this stuff. This is a ministry. We're reaching people with the gospel in this way. And I want to just, those are the two main areas right now, or three main areas right now, but it's going to continue to, we need to put the structure in place, we're working on that, but those are the three main areas right now that we especially need help. Continue to look at that job board, and we'll continue to post these things. And if you're leading a ministry, talk to us. Let me say this as well. If you believe in what we're trying to do here, we need you. You might look around and say, there's a lot of people here, but I don't believe it's an accident that you come here to worship. If you would like to get on board with what we're doing, talk to us. We want you on the team. We want you as a member of this church. This is not the kind of church that wants people to come and just sit here. We want people involved. We need you as a member of this church. You've been called here for such a time as this. Talk to us. We want you as a member. And let me just say this as well. This is not going to be cheap. Oh, here it comes. That's just a given, isn't it? This is not going to be cheap. But let me just say this. You can invest in the way that you can invest in the current arrangement, or you can invest in the kingdom of God. You tell me which one has better returns. Very soon, the current arrangement and the stuff of this world, you're not even going to have it anymore because you're going to be in glory. So here's the thing. Invest in the kingdom of God. It has the best retirement plan. It has the best returns. And the kind of place that we're looking for, the kind of ministries that we're trying to do, the kind of technology that we're trying to get so we can provide better ministries, it costs money. And I'm just going to be completely honest with you. We've added 100 members in about a year and a half. Our tithe has gone up, but not a lot. We need you to continue to fill out that little line on your envelope that says tithe. If you haven't started, please do. And then you'll notice under that, there's other lines. And some lines say it's for this, it's for that. Sometimes there's blank lines. On the blank lines, write, we need a new TV camera. Or new church. Or whatever you have a passion for, write it in there and give to that. This is not going to be cheap. And the fact of the matter is, we want a parking lot, right? We want bigger rooms for our kids. It's not free. Now, you can pray for that. Please do. We'd love to have a free church, a $1 church given to us, or ministry center given to us. That would be fantastic. But the fact of the matter is, my friends, I don't know that that would even be good for us. Do you know why? Because God wants us to invest in what we believe in. And if you believe in this vision and you believe in this identity, that means a test of faith is going to come in your wallet or your pocketbook. And by the way, if you want to test the Lord the most direct way, or you want to test your faith and trust in the Lord, the best way to do that is with your money. You'll see it right away. God won't leave you hungry, I guarantee it. It's going to stretch us. But I guarantee that as we come together, I know that it will glorify Jesus. And the blessings that we experience together will be beyond anything we could have ever imagined. Most of all, it will finally be what church is supposed to be. It will finally be what church is supposed to be. We've got little glimmers of it here. And I just want you to take notice. Look at what the little glimmers have resulted in. We've got glimmers of uplifting Jesus. We've got glimmers of building community. We've got glimmers of enriching lives. What happens if every single person in this church gets on board with that vision that we already have, with this ministry that we already have? Everyone's involved. We've grown by 100 members. The kingdom of God has been presented to more than 100 people, but 100 people have gotten on board seeing the light of God, seeing the light of the kingdom. We've grown by... What happens if everybody gets on board? What happens if we share in ministry and take responsibility to be the light in this community? What happens? We finally are the church for Minneapolis, and we show them what the kingdom of God is really like and what life was always supposed to be for. What happens if every single person engages in the work of restoring self-confidence in every soul? Restoring the self-respect of every person and showing them that God believes in them and that we believe in them too. We'll finally be what church is supposed to be. My friends, we are Southview. We are Southview. We are Southview, so we will uplift Jesus. We are Southview, so we will build community. We are Southview, so we will enrich lives. Are you with me? Are we together? This is who we are. It's who we already are. This is just taking this vision and taking this identity and saying, we are going to stir what we got because what we got is a lot. And we're going to use it for God's glory. And we're going to be the church here in Minneapolis because we have been called to this place for such a time as this. And how could we ever just sit here when the light of heaven has shined into our hearts? It's time to be the kingdom. It's time to be the church. It's time to be the light to our community. It's time to be Southview. Wouldn't it be wonderful that when people in this city hear the word Southview, they say, that's the church that uplifts Jesus. That's the church that works tirelessly to make connections and build community. That's that church that works to enrich lives through education and ministry and help. We want people to hear that word Southview, and we want them to think of Jesus and the kingdom of God. Can we partner together? Can we work for that goal? We are Southview. Let's be the light of Minneapolis because Jesus has been the light and shine light into our hearts. We are Southview. Let's sing.
Please stand.
Father in heaven, you have called this family together for such a time as this. Lord, we have the opportunity to enrich a life and show them, Lord, the kingdom of life and light. You have called us together for such a time as this, these people together in this place, to be the kingdom of God for this community. You have called us to restore the self-respect of all of your children so they are better able, with the noise of the world crowded out, to see that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. You have called talented people together, people in the arts, people in education, people that speak multiple languages, people that have experience in counseling, people that have been given means, Lord, together for such a time as this, not so that we can come to this place and stare at the back of each other's heads, but to be the kingdom of light in Minneapolis. And you have called us Southview. You've led us there. We are Southview to uplift our Savior, to build community and to enrich lives. Lord, thank you. May Jesus be glorified by us coming together and finally being the church. Thank you for these people. Thank you for this identity that you've given to us. Lord, we plead, we pray, deliver us a new ministry center. Deliver us a place, Lord, that's big enough for the ministry that we need and that we can do. Help us to be courageous no matter what the steps ahead are to fulfill your calling. Thank you, Lord, for calling us together in this place for such a time as this. May we be the light of this city. May we be the active, material hope for Minneapolis. May we show them Jesus. And it's in His wonderful name we pray. Amen. May God bless you. Have a wonderful day.